Alhamdulillah, respected brothers and sisters in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us in this world, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala made the purpose of life meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a clean heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On Judgment Day, no money, no children, no possessions, nothing will benefit you except meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a clean and healthy heart. What does qalb salim mean? What does a healthy heart mean? A healthy heart, we're not speaking here in the, you know, medical sense where my heart is healthy. We are talking about the diseases of the heart, the spiritual diseases of the heart. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, on Judgment Day you will come and this heart has to be clean. If this heart is sick, if this heart is not healthy, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all, then you might have to spend some time in the microwave where you purify this heart. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He described hellfire, what did He say subhanahu wa ta'ala? قَالَ وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ الَّذِي جَمَعَ مَالًا وَعَدَّدَهُ يَحْسَبُ أَنَّ مَالَهُ أَخْلَدَهُ كَلَّا لَيُنْبَذَنَّ فِي الْحُطَمَةِ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْحُطَمَةِ نَارُ اللَّهِ الْمُوقَدَةِ الَّتِي تَطَّلِعُ عَلَى الْأَفْئِدَةِ. Allah described the fire and said, this lit hellfire on Judgment Day will be searching and looking into the hearts. الَّتِي تَطَّلِعُ عَلَى الْأَفْئِدَةِ. Hellfire doesn't look at the book of your deeds. Doesn't look at your sins and hasanat and, you know, good deeds and bad deeds. It looks at the heart. تَطَّلِعُ عَلَى الْأَفْئِدَةِ. If your heart is clean, then you pass inshallah safely to Jannah. If your heart is sick, hellfire grabs you for a purification purpose. So we have to look into our hearts and see, are these hearts healthy hearts or not? Person is confused. How do I find out if my heart is healthy or not? Say, there are signs. There are signs of a healthy heart. There are signs of a believing heart. The first sign is that this heart is connected to the unseen. It's connected to the unseen world. For example, when I say to you, here Jannah, when I say paradise, what impact does that word or does that meaning have on our hearts? Ask any Muslim in the world, brother, sister, do you believe in Jannah? Are you keen to enter the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Everyone says, Allahu Akbar, mashallah, of course, yes. It's not really the question. The question is not whether we want to enter paradise or not. The question is, how much do you want to enter paradise? How much? How keen are you to reach the highest levels of Jannah? How keen are you to receive the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And when you ask anyone this question, he says, a lot. MashaAllah, I really want to go to Jannah. Say, brother, sister, unfortunately again, what we say in our tongues is different to what we have in our hearts. When I want to find out how keen a person is to do something, there are signs. A person wants to have a degree. He wants to attain a PhD. He's just finished high school. He's starting his university. And he has a straightforward, clear target to attain a PhD in a certain field. How much work is expected from him? How much effort and sacrifice is expected from him? For the next 4 or 5 years, you know, you're of uni, and then 2 years masters, and then maybe 3 or 4 years of PhD. For the next 11, 12 years of his life, this person will be studying. This person will be doing assignments, having exams, studying books, maybe research, maybe writing a paper. Why? He wants to get a PhD. It's not something simple. This is why there's a lot of people here. There's a lot of people in the world that would love to have a PhD. Ask anyone, would you mind having a PhD? He says, Allahu Akbar, a PhD. PhD is beautiful. Imagine having, you know, doctor beside my name. Allahu Akbar. But he doesn't want it that much that would make him study the 12 years. He would say, I would love to have a PhD, but I won't love it that much. I don't love it that to the extent that I would go out of my way and study for the next 12 years. I want to get married. I want to move on with my life. So it is not just about how much you want to enter Jannah. It is not only about how much you would love to go to paradise. It's about what plan do you have? What are you doing? What sacrifice are you doing to go to this paradise? This is why we call the path to Jannah, the path to Allah, the path of Mujahada. The path of struggle and sacrifice. You see, my brothers, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, حُفَّتِ الْجَنَّةُ بِالْمَكَارِهِ. Paradise was surrounded with things that the nafs does not like. We do not like. Struggle. You know, you want to go to Jannah, there's an effort that has to be made. حُفَّتِ الْجَنَّةُ بِالْمَكَارِهِ وَحُفَّتِ النَّارُ بِالشَّهَوَاتِ. But hellfire was surrounded with desires. Anyone who follows his desires, sleeps whenever he wants, wake up whenever he wants, eat whatever he wants, you know, drinks whatever he wants, has a relationship with whoever he wants, he does not have any limits to his desires. Whatever the desire and the nafs asks, he gives. Well, this person, where's he going to end up? He will end up in the hellfire. And some person, he controls his desires. He limits them within the boundaries of deen, the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person goes to Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى. As for him who transgressed, وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, and preferred this worldly life, فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Verily his abode, his final home will be hellfire. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ. But he who fears his Lord. In other words, وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. And he forbade nafs from following hawa, from following desire. وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Then verily, his home, his abode will be paradise. We want this. Does anyone here want anything else? Let's be very clear. We want to go to Jannah. We want to go to the highest levels of Jannah. Anyone with brains on him has to think that way. We want to reach the highest levels of Jannah. We have a problem in our time, my brothers. We have a problem. Some of our Muslims now, because our attachment to this world and lack of concern about the hereafter, people say, oh, all I want is just to enter Jannah. I just want to step there, man. I don't really want to be in high levels or anything. I just want to make it. Which, in appearance, this statement sounds very, very, very nice and humble. Like, you know, this guy, mashallah, like he's not arrogant, he's not boasting, he just wants to make it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ. He who just moved away from hellfire and enters Jannah, then verily he is successful. But these are not the meanings that should be in the heart. In dunya, in this world, we don't accept to be in lower levels. Everyone in this world loves status. People do anything for status. People pay thousands of dollars for status and fame and name and rank. We don't accept to be the lowest of the low in dunya. We want to be of high status. And this is only 60, 70 years that are absolutely insignificant. But in Jannah, we don't have that yearning. We are not as keen to be in the highest levels of Jannah. Something is wrong about this heart. This is why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, إِذَا سَأَلْتُمُ اللَّهَ فَسَلُوهُ الْفِرْدَوْسَ الْأَعْلَى. When you ask Allah, you ask for what? Firdaus, the highest levels of Jannah. You don't say, oh Allah, please just take me to Jannah. When we ask, we target Al-Firdaus Al-A'la, the highest rank in Jannah. We don't target any level in Jannah. Why? What is the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaching us here? See, when you, there's a lot of students, mashallah, that I've seen, you know, in the gathering, when you are studying and you have a subject that's, you know, they say if you target an A, you target, that's it, top marks. Sometimes you end up with an A minus, a B. You're really, really a flop, like a C, a D. But if you target a D, what ends up happening? You end up failing. You get an F. Very, very common rule, you know. You target a D, you end up failing. But you target an A, if you're a good student, you get an A, but if not, at least you get a B, a C, acceptable, pass. Likewise, when we target, we have to target Al-Firdaus Al-A'la, the highest levels of Jannah, to make sure, at least to make it to Jannah. But if I target just a step there, you end up, maybe, inshallah, Allah protect us all, falling behind of the requirement. This is why, my brothers, we need to learn how to love this paradise. We need to learn, we need to teach this heart, for it to be a healthy heart, how to be keen day and night. Your target is clear. You are focused. There's no disturbances. Everything, there's no distractions. My purpose in life is clear. I want the pleasure of Allah. I want to finish these 60, 70 short years and straight away go to the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum were like this. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught them well. He taught them well. They were focused, you know? They had the aim and purpose clear. Nowadays, our aim and purpose is shaky, unclear. One day deen, one day dunya, one day deen, one day. The purpose is unclear. We're not focused. Sahaba radiallahu anhum were focused and clear. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught them and he made them love paradise. When he spoke about Jannah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sahaba radiallahu anhum froze. The hearts were about to pop out from iman and belief in the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is enough that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this hadith, my brothers, when we describe Jannah and speak about Jannah, I always say that this hadith, it summarizes the whole topic. The Prophet of Allah says in Hadith Qudsi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ, I have prepared for my pious slaves مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ, what no eye has ever seen, وَلَا أُذْنٌ سَمِعَتْ, what no ear has ever heard, وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرْ, and the thought of which never crossed the human heart. The thought of Jannah, what is happening in Jannah, never crossed the human's heart. This final, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the great, Al-Azim, Al-Kareem, Al-Malik subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, the one who created us, the designer, the engineer of our body, the engineer that he created subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who installed the desires in you, now decided to please you. Now decided to suffice your desires. You know, to quench that thirst. Allahu Akbar. Words can never explain. Allah, this is where the language, you know, loses power and authority. You can't. Allah wants to please. So it's beyond our understanding. It's beyond our comprehension. This is why he says, وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. You know, sometimes as kids, we used to play this game. You know, someone would ask, when you go to Jannah, if you go to Jannah, you know, what will you ask Allah to give you? You know, so a little kid, you know, he's limited in his thought, you know. I have, mashallah, 6 children. Sometimes I think with my youngest boy, he's a very, very, very cheeky boy, you know. Very, very nice little kid. He's funny. So I sit down with him and I say, Muhammad, his name is Muhammad. I say, Muhammad, if you go to Jannah, what do you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you? So he thinks in depth, you know, he's a little kid. See, I will ask him to give me a big car. You know, like, he's a little kid. So his biggest dream, you know, in this world is to have like a big, you know, car with an engine, you know, that he can drive. Sometimes we'll say, oh, I'd like to have a sword or a toy or a game of some sort. And then we, as elderly people, we laugh at them. We say, look at the little kid. Wallahi, we are the same kid, exactly the same kid. Because whatever you dream of in Jannah, whatever you say, you know what, in Jannah, I want my palace, I want my hur al-ayn, I want my this, I want my that. Wallahi al-azim, even these thoughts, they are ridiculous. They are ridiculous thoughts. They are a reason for laughter. When you actually see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared. You see, my brothers, the ulama say, for someone to describe something to you that you have never seen before in life. Let's say, for example, I have a fruit. I have a fruit with me. It's behind the chair here. I've hidden it. None of you has never seen this fruit in his life. None of you has ever seen this fruit in his life. And I want to describe to you how it tastes like. What are my means of this description? Imagine a fruit, Let's say, for example, none of you has ever tasted mango before. You've never ever seen a mango fruit, never tasted a mango fruit. I want to explain to you how this mango tastes like. Can you describe to me the taste of mango? So, all I can say is, look, it tastes a bit, you know, like a mixture of this fruit and that fruit. Something you've tasted before, something that you have experienced before, and I tried to give you like a similitude, you know, something similar, so you can understand and comprehend. How about if it has no similitude? There's nothing like it. You've never seen anything like it. You've never tasted anything like it. Say to you, look, mate, here's the fruit. It's the only way. Taste it. Likewise, my brothers, there is nothing in this world that is like what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for the believers in Jannah. This is why it is all an issue of trust. A believer, he looks at the heavens and how intricate the details are of this universe, how beautiful and vast this universe is. He sees this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sees his qudra and his might and his power. So the result is the person has that confidence. Oh, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for believers in Jannah is not known. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum had this iman. This is why when this iman, when the heart became healthy, they worked hard for Jannah. Now waking up for tahajjud at night became easy because it's the price for something he really wants. You know, someone who is really in love. I really, there's a lot of, mashallah, young youth here. I'm in love with a girl. And, you know, I'm dying. I'll do anything to marry that girl. I'm in deep love. People start thinking, how can I prove this love? They start thinking of any sort and form of sacrifice that they're ready to give. Because he loves so much, he will do anything to please her. Why is Romeo so famous? You say, Romeo and Juliet. Why was Romeo so famous? Romeo was famous because the idiot, he killed himself for her. For his life. He took his own life, probably burning in hellfire now, just because of her. Because of a lady, you know? And she killed herself because she can't have a monster. So it became a famous story of love. Because they loved each other so much, they took their own lives. A big sacrifice, you know? Massive sacrifice. He gave her his life. This is a sign of how much he loves. You know, Qais and Layla, I've heard that. You know, in Arabic tradition, the poet, there was a poet called Qais. He used to run around, you know, wandering about in the desert, poetry all day, all night about Layla, his beloved Layla. You know, Layla. He wakes up in the morning, Layla, at night, Layla, by noon, Layla. He used to go to her house, sit outside, it's like kissing the you know, the walls of the house. He's in love. And he says in the poetry, أَمُرُّ عَلَى الدِّيَارِ دِيَارِ لَيْلَى وَقَبِّلُ ذَا الْجِدَارَ وَذَا الْجِدَارَ وَمَا حُبُّ الدِّيَارِ شَغَفْنَ قَلْبِي وَلَكِنْ حُبُّ مَنْ سَكَنَ الدِّيَارِ. It's not the love of the walls that I'm, you know, hit my heart. I love the walls because Layla is inside these walls. She kissed the walls outside, out of love. So we all say we love Jannah. What are you doing to prove that love? What is in your life? How much effort and sacrifice do you have in your life to get this Jannah? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the rule clear. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man khafa adlaj. Focus on this hadith, please. Man khafa adlaj, wa man adlaj balagha al-manzil. Ala inna sil'at Allahi ghaliyah, ala inna sil'at Allahi al-jannah. He who is afraid, ad-dulja is the, you know, it's a time in the night, the early portion of the night. The Arabs, they weren't like us, there was no electricity, you know, they used to actually, they can tell what time it is, what part of it of the night they're in from the darkness in the horizon, from the darkness in the skies, how dark it is. So they actually used to divide the night into parts and intervals, you know. So ad-dulja is an early part of the night. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, because they lived in Saudi, very, very, very hot weather, you know, in Hijaz, this area. So if someone wanted to travel, it was destructive to travel in the morning. Under the sun, that's you asking for trouble. You used to always travel at night. And if someone wants to reach the rest point, sort of the, you know, They used to travel in intervals. So from here to a rest point, from here to another rest point, like a safe area or a manzil. So if someone wants to reach the manzil, someone wants to reach the rest point before the sun rises, he has to start his travel early. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, gave us a parable for us to understand. قَالَ مَنْ خَافَ أَدْلَجْ. If you're worried that you won't reach the safety and security or the rest place, you start your travel early at the night. You don't wait and delay, oh, Allah, we'll get up, Allah, we'll move, and then, oh, before you know it, you can't make it before sunrise. No. مَنْ خَافَ أَدْلَجْ وَمَنْ أَدْلَجَ بَلَغَ الْمَنْزِلِ. He who starts early in his travel, he will reach the safe place, he will reach security. Then he makes a big switch. Must understand. قَالَ أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةٌ. Verily, the prize of Allah is valuable, is expensive. أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةِ. The prize Allah has prepared is Jannah. It's expensive. If you want Jannah, you have to start early. You have to work hard. You can't just be lazy and delay like we delay deen every day of our life. You have to start early and you have to work hard for a long time. You want to reach the highest levels of paradise, there has to be work, there has to be sacrifice. How much do we want Jannah is the question. See a great companion, an amazing story in the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Authentic hadith. Ever heard of Ahlul Suffa before? Ahlul Suffa are those poor migrants. The people who migrated to Medina, to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, but they own nothing in this world. We are talking about no house, no family, no wife, not even clothes to wear, no food, nothing. Some of them, even in Salat, they used to pray and parts of the awrah are showing. They used to hold their clothes together to avoid the awrah appearing in Salat. They used to faint. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was one of the famous people of Ahlul Suffa. They used to faint during Salat. People think they're epileptic, you know, it's epilepsy, but really it's all hunger pain. You'd collapse unconscious from hunger pain, radiallahu ta'ala anhum. So people who are doing a rock, hajar, you know, very, very poor, very limited provisions. So one man of these people, please memorize his name. Please learn this man's name, radiallahu anhu. His name is Rabi'a ibn Ka'b. Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Islami, radiallahu anhu. This man is one of Ahlul Suffa, there's around 70 something of them. 70 men who own nothing in this world. So he was once serving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was preparing his water for the wudu of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used that water, made wudu, he looked at him and said, Salli, ask anything of me, Rabi'a. Now please, for Allah's sake, try to read between the lines. I want you to understand this story in depth. Let's not be superficial. We wanna have an in-depth understanding of the situation here. This man owns nothing in the world, my brothers and sisters. He owns nothing. If he says to Rasulullah, and the Prophet of Allah is asking, and wallahi, every time I read this hadith, I can't help but have a feeling that even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asking him, he was actually referring to a worldly request. This man is nothing, he has nothing. So Prophet of Allah is pleased with him, he says, Salli. So it is as if the Prophet of Allah is telling me, what, how can I help you, Ya Rabi'a? Tell me, what do you want? And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the king of Medina. If he orders that this man gets married, what will happen? Done. If he says, build a house for him, done. If he says, buy him nice clothes, give him, someone lend him some money to start the business. So Rabi'a radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet of Allah asks him, Salni, look at the words, please. Look how focused these men are. Qala ya Rasulallah, as'aluka murafaqataka fil Jannah. O Prophet of Allah, I want to be in your companionship in Jannah. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. This man is not just targeting Jannah. He's not just targeting high levels in Jannah. He wants to be with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. Look how focused, look at the purpose, how clear it is. Qala ya Rasulullah, as'aluka murafaqataka fil Jannah. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam paused. And then he said to him, "Awa ghayra thalik?" Yani the Prophet of Allah was, I'm telling you, I can't help myself but feel that the Prophet of Allah was asking about dunya. I said, "Khalas, anything else?" Yani, ask. I know you're doing it hard. Ask. Aqala, "Awa ghayra thalik?" The Prophet of Allah, your teacher, is telling you, ask me. You can say, "Oh, Prophet of Allah, you know what? It would be nice to have a wife. Prophet of Allah, if I can get a house or a business." So this man says, "Huwa thak." That's all I want, ya Rasulullah. La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Nothing. He does not want anything else. And he's not lying to the messenger. He's not lying to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is saying the truth of what he has in his heart. This man's heart was clean. He was clear. He did not want anything of this dunya. He wanted to be in the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. All he wants. قَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهُ وَذَاكَ. This is my only target. This is the only thing I want. So look at the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after. So when the man insisted and the Prophet of Allah realized that his purpose is clear, the Prophet of Allah didn't say, "All right, I'll make dua for you." You know, sometimes you go to a sheikh and say, "Oh, please, sheikh, I'm, you know, this. All right, inshallah, I'll make dua for you." Although if the Prophet of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raises his hand, his dua is accepted. The Prophet of Allah, very, very powerful, you know. But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows that this rank, to get this rank, to be with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a lot more sacrifice required. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what? The words, قَالَ فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ. Rabi'a, if you want to be with me in Jannah, you want to be with me in Jannah, then assist me to overcome your nafs, overcome the nafs that wants luxury and rest and comfort and doesn't like, you know, sacrifice, doesn't like giving. قَالَ فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ. Assist me over your nafs by doing a lot of prostration. A lot of prostrations to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kathrat is sujood. This is why my brothers, the scholars of deen, they say that the sign of someone who wants al-firdaus al-a'la is tahajjud by night. They stay up. When people, everyone goes to sleep, when everyone khalas, khala kullu habibin bi habibi, everyone is with his loved ones, you know, lights are turned off, doors are closed, everyone khalas in his comfort, fulfilling his desires and his shahawat. These people, my brothers, they are soldiers. They are up by the night, begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this rank. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he prayed tahajjud, my brothers, wasn't like, you know, the nowadays in Ramadan, when the Imam reads one juz, one separa of the Quran, you know, people are, "Ooh, my legs are hurting, my back is killing me. This guy thinks he's in the haram, man. Let him relax a bit." We can't. One juz', two ajza', you know, 20 raka'at or 8 raka'at, whatever you pray, and you know, it's long, long. Can't handle it. Once Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, you know Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was a great soldier of deen. Mama, as we say in Australia. He is not normal, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This man was number 6 to accept Islam, Sada Sitta fil Islam. And the Prophet of Allah himself testified that his shins, his feet, they are heavier than Mount Uhud. Once he was climbing a tree, grabbing something for Rasulullah sallam, and the companions saw, he wasn't like a big boy, you know, he spent hours in the gym to be big. This man radiallahu anhu was a very, very, very simple, he had very, very, very small features radiallahu anhu. Yani his body is very, very thin, short, nothing big. But when he climbed that tree, Sahaba radiallahu anhum saw his feet from under his azar and they started giggling. amazingly thin. So the Prophet of Allah got angry sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قَالَ أَتَعْجَبُونَ مِنْ دِقَّةِ سَاقَيِّ. Are you making fun of his shins, of his legs? قَالَ وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَهُمَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَثْقَلُ مِنْ جَبَلِ أُحُدْ. By Allah, this man's legs, this man's shins are heavier than Mount Uhud. The Prophet of Allah is fixing our perception. It's not about how you look. It's not about how big you are. It's about how much you weigh in the sight of Allah. Who are you with Allah? This man was small, but his legs are heavier than Mount Uhud with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some people will come on judgment day, they're huge, they're big, but they don't even weigh nothing in the sight of Allah. Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yu'ta yawm al-qiyamah bil-rajul al-azim. A big man will come on judgment day, la yazinu inda Allahi janaha ba'uda. He doesn't have the weight of a mosquito in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing, he weighs nothing on judgment day. And some people will come thin like Ibn Mas'ud, but they are monsters and mountains of Iman. So this man, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, was a big alim of deen. He learned 70 surahs of the Quran, 70 out of the 114 surahs in the book of Allah, 70 of them, he learned them directly from the mouth of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Great scholar of deen, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This man says in the hadith, he goes, I prayed once behind Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praying, so he joined him in salah at night. صَلَّيْتُ خَلْفَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَأَطَالَ الْقِيَامِ. He stayed standing in salah so long, حَتَّى هَمَمْتُ بِأَمْرٍ سُوءٍ, until I intended to do something bad. What did you intend, Ibn Mas'ud? قال هممت أن أجلس وأدع. I thought of leaving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, leaving salah and sitting down, خلاص. Ibn Mas'ud could not keep up with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in salah. And Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu also, the secret keeper of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, a great companion. He goes, once I prayed behind Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, nafil salah, in tahajjud. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started reading Surah Al-Baqarah. So, you know, when you're reading behind an imam, you're praying behind an imam, and you know, the imam is reading, and you know the Quran also. Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, when he saw him opening Baqarah, Allah, very long surah, فَقُلْتُ يَرْكَعْ عِنْدَ الْمِئَةِ. He will read 100 ayat and then fall in ruku'a. فَمَضَى. فَفَضَلَهُ continued. فَقُلْتُ يُصَلِّ بِهَا فَلَكَ أَخْلَصْ. يعني, if he really exaggerates, يعني, he will read Surah Al-Baqarah in one rak'ah. So he say, خلاص, after Surah Al-Baqarah, he will fall in ruku'a. فَمَضَى. He continued. He started reading Surah Al-Nisa. This was before the Quran was put to order. You know? He started reading Surah Al-Nisa, another very long surah. So I said he will finish Surah Al-Nisa and make ruku'ah. He continued. He started Surah Al-Imran. Baqarah, Nisa, Ali Imran, close to 6 ajza of the Quran. Then he said what? يَقْرَأُ مُتَرَسِّلًا. He is reading slowly. He's not reading, you know, like sometimes we have the super turbocharged imam, you know. Beautiful, he said, MashaAllah, this Ramadan, I found the best imam in the world. In 20 minutes, you're back on the sufra. You're back on with the food again, you know. Alhamdulillah, very, very quick, beautiful mosque. The imam is like, you know, mashallah, very, very quick. Prophet of Allah is enjoying salah. يَقْرَأُ مُتَرَسِّلًا إِذَا مَرَّ بِآيَةٍ فِيهَا تَسْبِيحٍ سَبَّحْ وَإِذَا مَرَّ بِسُؤَالٍ سَأَلْ وَإِذَا مَرَّ بِتَعَوُّذٍ تَعَوَّذْ. Every time he passes by an ayah that has the glorification of Allah, he stops and starts glorifying Allah. Next tasbih. If he passes by an ayah that has, you know, seeking refuge with Allah, seeking protection, he starts making dua, asking Allah for protection. He passes by an ayah that has a dua in it, he makes the dua. Reading slowly, 6 ajza of the Quran. And then he fell in ruku'. Look at the amazing hadith. He fell in ruku'. فَكَانَ رُكُوعُهُ نَحْوًا مِّن قِيَامِهِ. He stayed in ruku', similar to what he stood up in qiyam. If the imam stays in ruku' for more than 1 minute in any salat, what happens to the musallin? A fight straight away happened in the masjid. Where do you think you are? You know, this is not rahmah, have mercy on the... People can't stand, they can't stand in salah. We can watch a soccer game for 3 hours. Football for 3 hours, easy. I can watch a Hollywood movie for 3-4 hours with a smile on my face, even though I saw it 10 times before. But come say, I'm a believer, mashallah, I have a clean heart. Start praying for more than 5 minutes. Boredom kicks in. Become uneasy, uncomfortable. You're not used to this. You're not enjoying your salat. This is a sign of a sick heart. A clean heart, they enjoy salat. They enjoy standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he knew that Jannah required hard work, he did that work. He went on for these, you know, sacrifices. Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they had that much trust and yaqeen in Jannah, they gave their lives. A great companion, called Anas ibn Nadr radiallahu anhu. Anas is uncle. You know Anas ibn Malik, the servant of Rasulullah? His uncle, Anas ibn Nadr radiallahu anhu. Anas ibn Nadr did not attend the Battle of Badr. Because the Battle of Badr was not intentionally a battle. They were going to, you know, attack the caravan of Abu Sufyan, a small brigade of the Muslims, 313 of them, unprepared army, a knife from the kitchen, a rock, a stick, something, you know, something funny. But it turned out to be a battle. So many Sahaba don't attend the Battle of Badr. So subhanAllah, when he missed the Battle of Badr, what did he say? After the battle, he found out that he missed the first big fight Muhammad Sallam had with the enemies of Deen. So he said, radiallahu anhu, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows me to attend the next battle Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam fights the enemies of Deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see what will I do. لَيْرَيَنَّ اللَّهُ مَا أَصْنَعَ. And he's not making claims like we claim, inshallah, I'll show you what I'll do. He's genuine. So the Battle of Uhud came. And when the Battle of Uhud came, the Muslims initially were winning the war. And then the problem with the archers, they disobeyed Rasulullah, and everything flipped over. And now the Muslims are running. In Kashaf al-Jaysh, they're being attacked from behind and from the front, confusion. Some Sahaba ran away. Some Sahaba sat down. What did this man do? He saw his companions running away, fleeing the battlefield. And he saw the enemies of Deen in front of him. So he raised his head to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, oh Allah, I am free. Inni abra ilayka mimma sana'a haula. I am free from what these enemies of Deen are doing. Wa a'tadhiru ilayka ma fa'al haula. And I ask your forgiveness for what our companions and our friends of Muhammad Sallam are doing, running away from the battlefield. And then he jumped on his horse and he flew in a suicide mission to the camp of the enemies of Deen. He flew, and on the way he saw Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu. On the way he saw Sa'd. And Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, just for your understanding, he's not a simple man. It's not like, he's a person with weak iman. Sa'd radiallahu anhu spent 7 years in Deen. He was the leader of Aus, one of the leaders of the Ansar radiallahu anhu. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, when he passed away, اهتز لموته عرش الرحمن. The throne of Allah shook when Sa'd radiallahu anhu died. Authentic hadith. The throne of Allah shook for the death of Sa'd radiallahu anhu. 7 years of Deen, but when he died, the throne of Allah shook after the battle of the trench, the battle of Al-Khandaq. So Sa'd radiallahu anhu, he was standing there confused also. Anas ibn Nadr radiallahu anhu, with no hesitation, with full trust and yaqeen, he happily wants to give himself for Allah. He ran with his horse, saw Sa'd, and then he screamed out to Sa'd. قَالَ يَا سَعْد الْجَنَّةِ. Oh Sa'd, paradise! إِنِّي لَأَجْدُ رِيحَ الْجَنَّةِ مِنْ دُونِ أُحُدْ. I can smell the fragrance of paradise beside Mount Uhud. And he wasn't exaggerating, he actually smelled paradise. So Sa'd continues the story. Says, and Sa'd is talking. Allahu Akbar, these people, Allah al-Azim, they had iman, my brothers, like mountains. So Sa'd radiallahu anhu is a believer. And a believer knows what he should be doing. So he saw Anas radiallahu anhu doing this, but he is honest. When he went back to Rasulullah after the battle, قَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فَوَاللَّهِ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُ مَا صَنَعَ. O Prophet of Allah, I could not do like Anas. They're genuine. They don't lie to the hearts. So the Prophet of Allah, I could not do like him. I wish I have done like him. I could not do like him, Ya Rasulullah. فَوَاللَّهِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُ مَا صَنَعَ. He went and started fighting, until after the battle, they found his body with 70-something wounds, injuries, either from a spear or an arrow or a sword, more than 70 wounds. وَمَثَّلَ بِهِ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. The enemies of Deen, they mutilated his body. They started tearing him apart. So no one could identify him except his sister. She found out it was him because of a mark he had on the tip of one of his fingers. لَمْ تَعْرِفُ إِلَّا أُخْتُ مِنْ بَنَانِهِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ. So this man, he wanted Jannah like we do. He wanted the high rank in Jannah. But his wanting is not like our wanting. How much he wanted Jannah is not like how much we want Jannah. We all say we want Jannah, we want Jannah. I'm going to go to Jannah. Wake up, pray 1 hour tahajjud every night. 1 hour? Are you serious, Sheikh? But it's summertime. You know what Fadhan Fajr is? Fajr is at 3:15, 3:10. Yani if I want to sleep a bit after Isha, if I'm going to sleep 2 hours and wake up, no way. I love Jannah and everything, but I want the easy path. Isn't there a shortcut? Find me a shortcut to Jannah. Like, I want to skip some, you know? I want to skip the wrong route. There's only one way to Jannah, my brothers. There's only one path called the Salat al-Mustaqim. You know, the system of Allah doesn't change. You want Jannah, sacrifice has to be made. Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they wanted Jannah and they understood ranks. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught them well. The teacher taught them well. He says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إن أهل الجنة. In Jannah there's also ranks, status. Between every rank and rank, they say there's 100 years. Or some narrations say the distance between the heaven and earth, between each rank. See, Al-Jannah, Allah says what? وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. The width of paradise, not the length of paradise, the width of paradise is the heavens and the earths. So we look at this universe, say, wow, you know? We don't even know how big the universe is now. Apparently the universe is growing. You know, we don't know. The closest star that we know of is like, if I remember correctly, like 4.1 light years away. The speed of light, the travel at the speed of light for 4.1 years, you reach the next star. And this is one star among billions of stars in our galaxy. And our galaxy is among billions of galaxies in the universe. And all of this is the first dunya. إِنَّ زَهَنَّ السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِزِينَةٍ الْكَوَاكِبِ. All the first dunya compared, the first heaven compared to the second heaven, is like what? It's like a ring in the desert. Absolutely humongous universe. And Allah says, عَرْضُهَا السَّمَوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. So Jannah is huge, beyond our understanding and perception. It doesn't make any sense anymore. Like, so when I say to you, 1,000 kilometers, say, wow, you know. I came from Australia, I traveled 14 and a half hours by plane. I don't know, like, maybe 14,000 kilometers or something, or 13,000 kilometers. Huge distance, you know. But we can still relate. That's a big. But if I say to you, 1 million kilometers, 1 million is like 2 million. Like, you don't sense the difference anymore. You don't feel any 2 million or 1 million. Khalas, 1 million, 2 million, 10 million, 1 billion kilometers. Khalas, it's beyond our understanding. So the width of Jannah is the heavens and the earths. And it has ranks in it. But Allah says, إِنَّ أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةِ لَيَتَرَأَوْنَ أَهْلَ الْغُرَفِ. The commoners in Jannah. In Jannah also there's commoners. أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةِ لَيَتَرَأَوْنَ أَهْلَ الْغُرَفِ. They see those in the rank of the chambers. There's a place, a rank in Jannah called Ahl al-Ghuraf, people of the chambers. Like, you know, the, what do you call it? You know, when you have like a big hotel and there's like the top level, you know, that's, I can't remember the name. A VIP, a penthouse, yeah, that's the word. Like, there's a penthouse on the top, you know? Ahl al-Jannah la yatara'awna Ahl al-Ghuraf kama tara'awna al-kawkab al-durira. Exactly like you see the star in the horizon. So you'll be sitting there and say, ooh, see that star there? I heard that, you know, such and such made it to this rank. Like, there's rumors going around in Jannah. So this guy made it there. إِنَّ أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةَ لَيَتَرَأَوْنَ أَهْلَ الْغُرَفِ. You see this rank of the chambers, exactly like you see the star in the horizon, in the east or the west. So when Sahaba heard this, they went like us. Their hearts are about to pop. They are dying. They are dying. They can't help the feeling that's overtaken them. قالوا يا رسول الله تلك منازل الأنبياء. Need Prophet of Allah. These chambers are made for prophets. يعني خلاص. A rank we can never reach. لا يدخلها غير يعني. Other than prophets, no one will make it. Allah said yes. ألا رجال آمنوا بالله وصدقوا المرسلين. People who believed in Allah and believed the prophets. Normal people. So when you hear this, what is the urge that comes in your heart? How much sacrifice are you willing to give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reach these ranks? This is the sign of iman. This is the sign of a healthy heart. If I see haram passing by and I can't lower my gaze, this is how cheap Jannah is in my heart. I'm willing to sacrifice paradise for insignificant, valueless desire in this world. Say, this is haram. Don't look, don't heed, don't fall in this sin. No. I leave deen, I leave the order of Allah, I leave the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam just for cheap worldly gain. Something very insignificant that has no value, I put that over Jannah. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا بِالْآخِرَةِ. Some people, they buy hayat dunya, they buy this world, and they sell the hereafter. They sell the hereafter, they sell something so expensive, so valuable, for something so cheap and so insignificant. He is not willing to sacrifice anything in this world. He wants to sleep long nights, he wants to follow his desires, and still he wants to go to the highest levels of Jannah. Impossible. You want to go to the highest levels of Jannah, sacrifice have to be made. Effort has to be exerted. Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they sacrificed. Da'wah, the hardships of da'wah they went through, the sacrifice for the deen, pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fasting in hot days, ibadah, dhikr of Allah, praying in the mosque, lowering the gaze, avoiding haram, patience and istiqamah on deen. They radiallahu anhum, they peaked. They peaked because of how much they wanted this Jannah. They were not willing to sacrifice Jannah for anything in this world. But our Jannah is not as valuable. We will forget about Jannah for luxuries of this world. This is why our deen is a cocktail. One day high, one day low. One day strong iman, one day weak iman. One day I'm pumped and I'm motivated, and the other day can't be bothered, man. I'm too tired, I'm too lazy. So we have to, my brothers, focus. The Muslim has to focus. They say failing to plan is planning to fail. When you have no plan, you know, when you have a big CEO of the company, and someone says to you, what's the strategic plan you have for your company? Say, strategic what? I don't know, we're just buying, selling, we're working. You're way behind the world, mate. You will never ever compete in this market. People with big companies, they have a plan, a marketing plan, a strategic plan, a R&D for the next 20, 30 years. They pre-plan, they focus, they sit down, they make a target. So every Muslim, he must apply these principles. All right, I want to be with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. What does that require? Can I be lazy? Can I sleep? Can I miss the Hajjud? Can I not pray in the mosque? Can I not work in da'wah? Can I leave the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? If this is your target, everything will become clear. But when you flop and you're not keen and you don't care anymore, this is when deen becomes hard. You are ticking off boxes. You know, we come for salat, why? Not because I'm enjoying salat, not because my heart is clean. I'm talking to Allah and Allah is talking to me. Alhamdulillah, Isha, done. I can't wait for the Imam to say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah to go back to my dunya. Even though I pray, but my heart is not there. Even though I'm reading Quran, I'm just ticking off the box. Ticking off boxes doesn't work with deen. In deen, we want the heart. We want clarity. So we have to focus, my brothers. Make our purpose, make our desire, make our hearts love Jannah and strive for Jannah and work hard every day, you know. Have you ever seen boxers when they train? Sure, many of you watch the Rocky movie, you know. You want to become the champion? You have to go through that process of hardship and sacrifice to reach your aim, to reach your target. You know, like they wake up in the morning and that's it, you know. Eye of the tiger, and I'm jogging and I'm running, and you know. You want to reach Jannah? You have to follow the path of Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Their path, their sacrifice, their giving. Whatever they could, they sacrifice. You know, Suhaib al-Rumi radiallahu anhu, he was migrating from Mecca to Medina. He arrived Mecca as a slave, a Roman slave, and worked his way up the ladder until he became a businessman with, you know, a lot of money. When migration came and deen came to enter his heart, iman entered his heart, he wanted to migrate to Rasulullah sallam. The kuffar, the enemies of deen, when they found out, they ran after him, they followed him, and they caught him midway. So he said, stop there, you know I'm a very good archer, and I'm gonna finish these arrows before you get me. We'll have a fight. Maybe you'll get me, but I'll finish my arrows first. If you want, I can give you my money and let me go. Let me go to Rasulullah Sallam. So he gave them everything he owned. Imagine working 60, 50 years in this world from zero, from scratch. You started rock bottom, all your savings, all the money you have. He said, I'll tell you where my money is. Take it all and let me migrate to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he sacrificed all his possessions to migrate to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So when he arrived in Medina, the Prophet of Allah was waiting for him, saying to him, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعَ أَبَا يَحْيَى رَبِحَ الْبَيْعَ. Your business deal with Allah was successful, ya Abu Yahya. Your business deal with Allah was successful. He sacrificed something very insignificant for something great. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayah in the Quran, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْرِي نَفْسَهُ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ. Some people, they sell their own selves to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you want to be these people. We want to work hard for deen. No more sleep and laziness and, you know, oh, I can't, and lack of motivation. We want to be focused. If you want Jannah, you want the highest ranks, you have to work hard. You have to start early. You can't delay. It's a big assignment that we all need to work for. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who practice what we hear. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعلنا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك جزاكم الله خير وبارك الله فيكم.